deck, but my name is Megan Murphy, and I am from Peterborough, so I know Grimsby. My film is called Murphy's Law. My background is I went to York University for theater, so I had a majored in theater performance and minored in international relations, thinking I could save the world through art. Very lucrative. Great life choices. And then I work in radio. I host a couple of morning radio shows, and I do some improv and acting, and then I went back to school a few years ago for documentary film. Because after a while, you realize as an actor, you don't really get to tell a lot of great stories. You do a lot of important commercials. And so I started to want to tell real people's stories. And a few years ago, my own life fell apart, and I thought, well, if I'm asking everybody else to tell their story, then I better tell my own. So this is a very personal story. I'll show you my trailer, and then I'll tell you a little bit about it. Nothing like life falling apart for some good art.
An Irish proverb says, "Your feet will take you where your heart is."
Good times.
I am not a cyclist. I haven't been on a bike in 25 years. And this isn't just any bike. It's my dad's.
I am terrified and completely thrilled.
This all started after both my parents died of cancer. I felt lost without them. So as I'd done my whole life, I turned to my dad for advice and listened to the tape he'd left me.
You have asked, where should you travel? Ireland. Always Ireland.
And then I found his journal from his own bike trip around Ireland. It seemed obvious what he was telling me to do.
This is going to be the longest bike trip in the history of the world.
That's nice.
I figured it should be his own bike and his own journal. I feel like she knows she's back.
Seriously, Dad? You couldn't have done a pub crawl around Ireland? No. You had to be a hero. You had to ride your bike.
Woo-hoo! So we light a candle for me ma and me da.
Essential.
Do you think he did?
I do. He's helping you from the grave. You know?
Hey, Dad.
Look at the chimney.
Hi, Mom. Hi, Mom.
Ah, this is so amazing.
But if I get a chance to back out, but I know you guys will do that for me someday.
You can follow someone's footsteps, but the scenery's never the same. So you gotta ask yourself, why am I doing this?
Okay. Woo! You come see it at one and then that's it. Any questions? I totally feel your pain because filming, oh, I feel so much of your pain right now. Filming outside, Ireland is not known for a great climate. So there's rain that you're contending with. I was wearing many hats as well. So you were cycling all day, and then you have the crew, and you're lugging camera equipment, and you're trying to set up a shot, and you'd set up a shot on the top of a hill. I was directing it, so you'd set up something like, oh, this is gonna be beautiful. And then you ride your bike down the mountain, and then you think, okay, now be a daughter who feels, actually experience this, ride up the hill. And then the DOP would go, that was great, we're going to do it again, just in the closer. Okay, no problem. It was just constant. Like, I thought, oh, and then you get back at the end of the night and I'd have to do all the loading, you're downloading all the footage and erasing the card, which makes you panic every single time that maybe you didn't get your footage, and then start again the next morning. And I was like, why have I done this? This is the stupidest thing I've ever done in my life. But also the best thing, like many things like that, that are, you want something that's going to be hard and that pushes you, and the rewards are great from that. So I know the name of the session was Connecting with Nature, but I don't know that mine was as involved in terms of nature, other than it's Ireland and it's beautiful, so everything you shoot is gorgeous. But I thought I'd talk a little bit about connecting with human nature, and that was sort of what my film was about. So when my my story, because I sort of touched on it a bit, and you see from there, but it was my 35th birthday, and I had ended my engagement, and I moved back into my parents' house, and my mom had just died, and it was a very, very low time when I found my dad's journal. And I've been an artist for a long time, and when I found his book, I thought, I was almost irritated, like, I had to do this. It was so poetic that I knew I had to do it, and I was kind of annoyed that it happened. I don't really have the energy to do this, but I figured that it's exactly like you said, that you have to make something out of it. You have an idea, and you go, well, I'm an artist, I better create something. Because in doing this, and I've always known it, but in doing this film, you realize that although it is a very personal experience, it's a totally universal story. So people will resonate, it will resonate on some level. And the idea of being as vulnerable as possible, at first I thought I might be navel-gazing, this might not be very interesting, I don't wanna feel sorry for myself, I don't want it to look like, oh, look at me and my life and my family. How do I tell a story that has the essence of humanity without it seeming like it's narcissistic, and that is able for someone else to be able to look at it themselves and not also be totally terrified that you're putting your own life and opening your journal and your whole life and putting it on a screen. And I realized in being vulnerable that it actually was very empowering, and the more honest I got and the more authentic I got with it, the less I had to be afraid of. So the entire journey was very, as an artist, it was really fulfilling, but as a person, it was really raw and cathartic and healing for me too. There's another problem with my film, was that one of my main characters is dead, so your footage is limited. So I had thankfully, a lot of archival footage. My dad had done a lot of shooting in our lives. I remember growing up with this ginormous VHS camera that had a light that sort of burned your eyes out, and it attached to cords that had the actual tape that went into it. So thankfully I had a lot of footage, and some Super 8 footage, but it was difficult to create a story. I wanted people to fall in love with him, I wanted people to know him, and I couldn't shoot anything new with him. So trying to craft a story around someone that doesn't exist here anymore was very difficult. I thought that was a kind of interesting process of how you tell someone's story that isn't around. And what else was I going to talk about? Oh yeah, and the use of archival footage, so that's a tough one. Did you use archival in yours at all, or was it all fresh? Yeah. That was tough too, because I had so much footage. I had about 50 or 60 hours of home movies, and then I had about 50 hours of footage from Ireland. So I'd watch it all, I'd document it all, and then you find some great nuggets, and you think like, how I want to shove it all into this film, and you realize you can't, and when I was in theater school, I used to have to cut stuff, and we'd always go, it's like killing your baby because you love it so much. You're like, just kill your baby. Which one's their least favorite baby, and kill it. And so there's a lot of that where I'm like, no, like grieving for this little part, and you have to get rid of it. And so there's so much that you have to leave out. But I love the use of archival because it can add texture when it's done well, and it can add elements that you wouldn't normally think of. But putting too much in is a problem because it dilutes it, and it dilutes the point. Putting it too little in doesn't give you enough of a feel for it. It's a little too, a little bland still. So finding that balance was difficult for me, and parting, because it was my own story, parting with that was sometimes hard because I would fall in love with something because it meant something to me, but it didn't serve the story. So I was editing it myself, and then there came a point where I thought, that girl's annoying me. I'm watching my own face for 8 hours a day, and I was like, oh my God, she talks a lot, and I hate her, she's so annoying. So I hired someone whose film I had seen, and I liked it, I liked him, I didn't know him, he was an introvert, he didn't care if he was nice to me, it was perfect, because he didn't want to talk, he'd get down to work, he was not precious about any of it, and this is amazing, I love you so much. Because he could go, I know you like that, but that's not good. I was like, okay, this is perfect. So it was great because it made me divorce myself from the material. Yeah.
I just noticed about when you, for filmmakers, you have to hear their own voices. We're so critical about ourselves though, and yeah. I can relate to that too, because every time I hear my own voice,
yeah,
I just want to punch that person.
Yeah.
So, but
I know.
It's a habit though too as well.
Yeah. Yeah, you're totally right. Right. And it does, it's freeing though, because you get used to, you know, you have nothing left to hide when all of your stuff is there. So you kind of, you have to befriend yourself, which is nice. And so this process was a lot of that for me too. But oh my God, like I've edited other films and short films, and you get annoyed at people's habits and idiosyncrasies only because you have to try to find, like, please finish a sentence. When you're editing something and people have a tendency to go off in these directions, you're like, I just need a point where you took a breath so I can edit. And then I'm watching myself do it, go, oh my God, like, stop talking for 5 seconds, so finish a thought. So I was, you know, you realize your own downfalls. And so for my film as well, I was able to, it was because it was similar to yours, where I had the idea, I was sort of broken in my own life and knew that I needed to, when I found my dad's journal, I saw his bike and I thought, I'm gonna do this thing. And I had no idea what I'm getting into, which was probably a great idea because if I had known, I probably wouldn't have done it. And then I thought I needed to create something. So funding came sort of secondary to the idea. I did a crowdfunding campaign, which raised $25,000, and that paid for my production costs overseas. And then I got a small grant, a $20,000 grant as well, for an editor, and then the rest is out of my own pocket too. So inheritance, go inheritance. So it was amazing to have that type of support and sort of build in your audience a little bit before I even left, so that you knew people who were invested. And I also blogged while I was away, so part of my Indiegogo ran while I was gone, so I was sort of manning that while riding my bike, filming the movie. And then, you know, some of my things were kicks of my Indiegogo perks were things like, I'll send you a postcard or I'll do whatever. So you're writing postcards at 1 a.m. So it was a lot of work, but I'm glad I was slightly ignorant to how much work it would be, because I probably wouldn't have done it. Are there any questions? Should I do that first? Yes.
When you went on your own, did it ever occur that
I think for me it was, I have two sisters and we're very close, I'm in the middle. My sisters and my aunts and uncle came to meet me. There's a chair to my dad's memory at the very end of the Dingle Peninsula on the most western tip of Ireland. And so my last day of cycling was to my dad's chair, and my sisters and my family met me there. But it's funny because I'm so close with them, but we're so similar, but we're so different. When I found my dad's journal, I was giving away a box of books. I found it under the stairs, cleaning up their house, and it was sort of sticking out in the corner of these other books. And I knew instantly, you know, your heart's going, I was like, oh my God, and it's his writing, and it's got pint glass marks, and it was all torn up, and it had smoke damage from this fire they'd had. I was so excited, and I was voraciously reading it. And I told my sisters, and they were really excited, but to this day, neither of them have read it. And they've read parts of it, but they've never read cover to cover. And they were so supportive of me. And it wasn't until I'd started the process that then I had to ask them. It didn't even occur to me. And then I said, are you okay with this? Because they're quite introverted and private, and suddenly I'm splashing their life and our family. And it's my version of, you know, my own history with my dad, but they're in it all over the place. And one of my older sisters said to me, well, do I have a choice? Yeah. No, but you know, I'll respect it if you do have a problem. They said, no, we know you need to do this, but I would never do this. So I'm lucky that they were gracious about it. But yeah, it is, and that is because it's personal. There are a couple of times that my dad talks, I find out sort of through the journal that he was quite depressed, which is why he went on this trip, and he speaks a little bit about suicide. And I had no idea growing up that I knew about the trip, but I had no idea really part of the emphasis for why he went. So when I was actually putting that in the film, one of my uncles had trouble with that because he thought that I was, he said, that's not, you know, who your dad was. I said, well, he wrote it. It's not, I didn't make that up, but he didn't want any that sort of stigma attached to my dad or his memory of my dad. So you realize in doing a personal family story, that although it's mine, it is theirs. And they were pretty gracious with me about letting me do that. Did you have a question?
Yeah, did you transfer over the archival footage into
that? That was expensive.
Yeah.
Super fun. I did it at this place in Toronto, Discreet Frame. So I took a ton of my footage in there, and I found Super 8s that had never been developed. I found my parents bringing me home from the hospital, like old footage that was really great, but it was quite expensive to transfer it all over. Mm-hmm. But I did transfer all over, and I watched it, and I'm an old school like paper and pen girl, so I watched it and I transcribed all of it, which was good. And I feel like that was another thing for me too, is we can document things so easily, and we have our cell phones and we take pictures and videos, and I mean, my nieces are tiny and they know how to look at everything, and they've seen themselves since the day they were born. And so, but there's something less precious about it, and I think we don't treat it as well, because it used to be so much work and it was so expensive. And so I'm lucky because I grew up in the early 80s, and my dad would lug all this stuff, and none of my friends have footage of their early years, but he would bring all this equipment to our first communions or to our whatever. So I have that all, but it was expensive and you had to think about it. And now we shoot, but we don't think. And so I feel like we don't actually watch our footage back the same way. We don't document things as well. It's not as precious anymore. So it's made me think about how I want to continue to document our lives. And oddly, I take less footage now on my camera. I take less video, which is a bit sad, because I just feel like it's so easy that none of it means as much. So I'm trying to kind of redefine my relationship with footage and documenting our lives, because I think it's very important, but I'm not sure that we do it effectively right now.
Do you find it, what I always thought was that my parents did it as, or my father was like yours, but with the film camera.
Yeah.
And then the VCR later on, but it was more of a journey.
Mm-hmm.
To watch them, we'd have Saturday nights where we just sat and watched slides and
yes.
all the old movies and everything else. And it was like a journey and our story kind of thing, whereas now it's more trivia.
It totally is. Yeah, or watch this funny thing or whatnot, yeah. And even in my dad's journal, it's quite neat because he's a prolific writer who's very good, profound. He was 26 when he wrote this, and I can't believe it still because it's so beautiful, and I use a lot of his journal in the film. I had an actor read some narration from his journal. But he writes little things like private note, as though someone was going to read it, and he'd write a note to my mom or something in there, and they were still dating at the time. But then he would write things like, clearly, he said, this is from, this. I took a picture of this, I'll show these slides when I get home. So he had an intention, and I guess it did happen, that he had the whole family together and showed them. Where the world has gotten so, it's, in a way, it's so lovely that you can get anywhere and go anywhere and do anything.
Show your phone.
Yeah. But even when I was in Ireland, like when my dad was there, he's writing all this stuff, and it was still pretty uncommon. Like he was the only cyclist, and he went out to the Blasket Islands and the Aran Islands, and there was no power on the islands. There was, you know, and now you can get anywhere, you can do anything, there's Wi-Fi, there's blah, 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 blah. And so in a way, you're like, oh, we can get anywhere, so everywhere is a little less tasty. So it's trying to find, again, for me, it was like, where do I find a place in the world that is as unique, as interesting? Where do you find an experience where you go, this is so hard, like, unless I'm going to go, which I might just apply. Date one of them. You know, it's hard to find a spot where you're alone, where it's quiet, where you can actually think, and you know, that's very difficult to find that now. Yes?
Because when you're in front of the camera, there's that element of you're very aware you're on camera sometimes.
Yes.
What ended up being the most cathartic thing in this process? Was it pre all the production and you're just sitting and reading the journals, or was it the film's done and how you
That's a good question. There were a few. I wanted to have some sort of, you know, top of the mountain moment. I'm like, I feel it all, I get it all, and I'm Brahma. Like, I wanted that, even though I was pretending I didn't. And I don't think I got that when I was in Ireland. I think I've had a lot of that, not a lot, but I've had some of that sense when the whole process is done and you can digest it. And, but it was just so much work. It was so much work when you're doing it. And it broke you. Like, I was just it was so exhausting on every level, which was great. But yeah, I think it was so difficult. I don't know really what I was expecting, but I don't think it was incredible. It was horrific, it was torturous, and it was awesome, all rolled into one. There was a moment though, I had a film crew, I went with a Canadian cinematographer. I hired an Irish sound girl, and then my aunt and uncle came as my drivers for them. And the cars in Ireland are tiny, and the road roads are tiny and like everyone's jammed in with like equipment coming out of everything, and oh, it's hilarious. And what was the point of that? Oh yeah, I had them for 10 days and then I was on my own for 12 days. And then at the very end of the trip, I hooked up again with an Irish cinematographer and the same sound girl for 3 days. So that time in between, I brought a little cam just in my panniers, and I thought I had this vision of doing sort of diary type entries that would be similar to his journal, reflect that. Day one, I'm out, I've like left everyone behind, and I'm like, okay, here I go on my own, like I'll just experience this. And, I was riding along these tiny roads. A car came out and passed, another car didn't see me and almost hit me. So I had to swerve and I went into a stone wall and my camera smashed.
Whoa.
So, like 2 hours out. And so you're kind of going Murphy's Law, obviously. And I'm like, this is amazing. And then there was another side of me that thought, like, okay, when I get to the next big city, I'll get to Dublin eventually and I'll get a camera. And I was like, no, just experience this and there'll be no footage and just be here. And I had no data on, and I was trying to find my way around, and like, you find there were some great stories too. The Irish are incredible. And I had met this one fella out on the Aran Islands who said, well, you know, when you get to this part of County Clare, you know, look us up, we're having a music party. And I was like, all right, that's cool. They're either great or I'll die, one or the other. I'll get murdered and it'll be fantastic. There's no way of knowing. So I'm out, he says, there's no street names, there's no, like, you go by people's houses, or it's ridiculous, so. I'm trying to find my way. And they said, it's easy, and it's not easy. And I'm in the middle of nowhere, and so I finally turn on my data to try to find where the hell I am. And it's just spinning, and there's nothing happening, because it has no idea where you are. And so I run into this fella, he said, I'm trying to find Paul Johnson's thatched cottage. Is that a ridiculous question? He goes, oh, no. What should you do? You go down this road. You'll go down, and it'll go up again, and it'll come down. It'll go up one more time, you come down. On your right, Mrs. Kennedy's. Now, she makes the best food return. You'll continue. Don't stop there. Go left. You'll come around. There'll be some water. Don't bother. Keep going. You'll get to like a T junction, but it's like a drunk T. It's not an angle. Now, when you get there, there's the fella's house on the left. Ask him. He'll point you the rest of the way. I'm staring at him like, you're serious? Okay. Sure enough, there's like a drunk T, and there's the guy. I'm like, oh my God. So yeah, and then the next day when they told me to leave, they drew the directions on a paper plate, and it was not written, it was drawings of like, go across this bridge, you go across here, and I got on the front of my bike, like it was fantastic. So it was a bit of an adventure every level, which was great. And it's been an adventure since too with the film. The film has connected to a lot of people, which I love, and people know loss. I don't think we grieve very well in our culture, and so this, I think we are fast to grieve and fast to move on, and we're uncomfortable with it, and it takes a long time. Grief takes a long time, and it changes you. So I wanted this film to explore my own grief and story, but I wanted it to give permission to other people to feel what you need to feel, and to go into that and take the time. And I was very lucky to, when you're on a bike for 8 hours a day and there's nothing to think about, you're just with yourself and your sore bum and your own thoughts. And I was very lucky to have that time and to take that time to just spend it with my folks and with and with myself and riding my way sort of back to myself. So I'm grateful, because I think through this film and through art, and what I love to do is connect people, see the little connections between each other, and whether it's through nature and connecting to that, to your art that then is transferable to an urban center, like it's all about connecting and how connected we are, and using film and documentaries. I mean, it doesn't have to be like a universe, or it doesn't have to be like a specific truth. I'm more interested in the essence of the humanity of it all, of story. Any other questions? Mm-hmm.
Can't wait to see you when you're done.
Play that one.
Yes.
You can come and see it. Do you have any other questions?
When they were like planning your route of where you're actually going to go, so they were with you for 10 days, and then would you schedule like, okay, we'll meet up at this location because it's a landmark or important to the story or something like that? Or how did you plan the logistics?
Yeah, that was also a nightmare. So great in one way, because I had my dad's journal, so I knew where he had gone, and I tried to find the same places he'd stayed. Many of them didn't exist, or they were like, adorable bed and breakfast or things like that. And I had the crew crew I needed to sort of figure out, which dictated the distances I had to go for the first while, which I was terrified about, because in reality, I found January is when I ended my engagement and I moved home. I found his journal in like February. March, I thought, okay, I'm doing this, took his bike in at the beginning of April. It wasn't done till middle of May, so I had 6 weeks to train and go. So I got it all together and the film together and trying to cycle all together within 8 weeks, maybe. So it was just, you know.
You did that, quick in terms of like the inception of the film and all of that, like that.
Yep.
Was
it was crazy, right? It was crazy.
That's crazy.
I didn't have time to watch, like I didn't watch all my home movies. I was just trusting that I'm going to have, there's going to be something here. And I had this cassette tape that my dad had left, my sisters and I, before he died, and I had not listened to it in about a decade, but I knew it was there, and I knew my dad was poetic. I knew in my gut there was something. And you know when there's something. And I was like, I have to do this as a daughter, I have to do this, and there'll either be something or there won't. And then when the crowdfunding took off, I was like, there better be something.
Yeah.
Oh my God. So my panic started sort of after, when I was like, and thank God there was stuff. And there were discoveries I made, come watch the film, and there were discoveries I made after, like 6 months after I got back, that blew my mind, that I had no idea before I'd ever left. Because in a way, I was prepared, but I was ill-prepared. Yeah, and I knew if I'd waited a year, I wouldn't have needed it, it wouldn't have been the same, so I needed to go. I forget what the question was.
Logistics.
So I knew all the spots, and then I knew after that, so there were times where we would have to, there were a few times poetic license where I would have to, we were running out of daylight, and I would have to throw everything in the car, take your bike apart, put it in the car. That shot where I'm coming through a tunnel, and it's a humongously long, dark tunnel. So we set the shot up, and my dad had gone through it, and he talks all about it. So I'm like, okay, you guys go to that end, we look at the thing, we figure it out, I ride back, I cycle through the tunnel, and then we have to do it again. Okay, quick, we gotta throw everything in the car, so we take the bike apart, all the equipment gets in the car, and we're driving away, and for whatever reason, I look back, and there's my wheel is on the side of the road. I'm like, whoa! So we get that. So we would have to do some driving, and then the next day, I would go back and cycle it so that I was
authentic. You did your dash. So
yeah. Yeah.
Cool.
So there's a part, and when I was on my own, I recycled Dublin to Galway, so I did it twice because there were parts I had to drive, and I was like, I need to make this real. I was quite proud of my quads when I got back. I'd make everybody feel like, I'm going to check this out. And then I sat down and ate pizza for like 2 months and lost it all, so it's fine. Yeah, so I did cycle the whole thing, and there were parts I had to do twice. And there's a lot more cars now, and there's a lot, like, it was a difficult cycle. There's no shoulders on the road, so it's difficult filming, difficult cycle. But really rewarding. And stuff even now where I'm like, oh, I should have done this as a shot, or I should have. But it's hard when you're wearing all the hats, too, to be able to separate yourself sometimes.
Was post-production on you as well?
It was me, and then when I hired a fella to do editing for me, which was great, so I had a whole bunch of, an assembly together, and then I had him come in, which was amazing, and then whittled it down, and then I did the narration, I did the writing, and then I did, then I hired someone to do some original score, so he's a great guy. I had a small budget for that, and then some people did. One girl wrote me a song while she was following the blog, and she wrote a song, I said, I hope this isn't weird, while I was cycling. She wrote a song and emailed it to me. It was really rough on her iPhone with piano, and I'm listening to it in the middle of Wexford somewhere, and I'm like, so I asked her if I could use the song, and it's in the film too, and so we produced that when she got back, and so there were some really, people really came together for me in it too, who were quite generous of themselves, but I did pay everybody who was involved even something, but I was upfront with what I could afford. Yeah, I feel like people need to be, I'm not a big advocate of asking artists to do things for free, because I do a million things for free, and then, you know, I really want to support people and make, I think it's important that we value that, and people value what they pay for, and so I didn't want to ask anyone to just give up their time without compensation for something. Yeah, it was important to me to do that.
Cool.
I'm going to cut it off because we all have to get over there. We can't miss this film. What's going to happen at 1? But thank you so much, Megan and Calder, and can't wait till we all get in there and watch these movies.
Yeah, thank you so much. Thanks for having me.